Tonight he will examine the merits of Commentary Magazine. Conrad Lynn.
In 1946, I subscribed to a new magazine, Commentary, which came out after the end of the Second World War with the expectation that here would be a serious magazine on the left which would examine the burning issues following the Second World War in depth. In that first, in those first issues, and this was in the masthead for many years, these words: in sponsoring Commentary, the American Jewish Committee aims to meet the need for a journal of significant thought and opinion on Jewish affairs and contemporary issues. Its pages will be hospitable to diverse points of view and belief, and it hopes to encourage original creative endeavor in the various fields of culture. That was the July issue, 1949. But all the issues for many years had that masthead. The masthead of the latest issue of Commentary begins very much the same way. In sponsoring Commentary, the American Jewish Committee aims to meet the need for a journal of significant thought and opinion on Jewish affairs and contemporary issues. The opinions and views expressed by Commentary's contributors and editors are their own. Now, it almost seems that that is the same, except that in the first issues, as I read to you, the announcement was made that Commentary would be hospitable, its pages will be hospitable to diverse points of view and belief, and it hopes to encourage original creative endeavor in the various fields of culture. Now, why is there such a difference between the magazine Commentary in January 1983 and the magazine Commentary in those first years after the Second World War? Looking at Commentary today, we see that the first advertisement is from the Heritage Foundation. And most of us know that the Heritage Foundation is sponsored by the very conservative upper middle class in America, and it sponsors all organizations who have a status quo or even reactionary position. Now, going further into the magazine, before the first article, we have an advertisement about payroll dollars are 50% more productive in Puerto Rico than the total U.S. average. This is an advertisement for businessmen to invest in Puerto Rico and build factories down there. They talk about the quality of our workforce. They soon develop an enormous respect. Although federal minimums apply, in 1982, our average wage including fringe benefits, was $6.02. On the mainland, it was $11.62. So we see that the commentary magazine has become an organ of big business in America. And fittingly enough, the main article in the current issue, the first article, is by a James Neuchtelein. He's an associate professor of American Studies at Valparaiso University in Indiana. And the article is called The Republican Future. Now, James Neuchtelein wrote the article after the defeat of the Republicans in the November 1982 elections. But he is not at all depressed. He begins, "What happened in last November's congressional elections is what did not happen. An apt summary of the election results might read, no realignment, no repudiation." Now, and he goes on, the whole point of his article is to prove that the Republicans really did not suffer a defeat. All they need to do is to regroup. They have in Reagan one of the most convincing presidents this country has ever had. Let me read the last paragraph of his article. "Finally, the Republicans have, in President Reagan, the most effective political leader of recent times. Yet with all due credit to the president's formidable skills, he and his conservative movement owe much of their political success to their opponents' excesses over the past two decades, as Pine's analysis suggests. A politics originating in reaction to ideological ultraism always risks ideological extremism of its own. Ronald Reagan is a deeply persuaded conservative, and no one could reasonably expect him to become something other than what he is. He has won being what he is. But governing is the art of the achievable. If Reagan can keep his ideological instincts as his servants, as his servant and not his master, if, that is, he can govern remembering that he leads a country first, a party second, and only then a political movement, he could become the most successful American president in half a century." That's the stand of Commentary Magazine today. And going further in this latest issue of Commentary, the January 1983 issue, we have an article on anti-nuclear fantasies by a man named Patrick Glynn. Now, Patrick Glynn is engaged in reviewing two books. One is by Lifton of Yale. Let me find that book. Robert J. Lifton of Yale, the psychiatrist who's very well known, and Richard Falk, the international lawyer from Princeton University. They have written two books. Lifton and Richard Falk have written one book together, Indefensible Weapons, The Political and Psychological Case Against Nuclearism. And he's also reviewing a book by a great English political scientist, E.P. Thompson of Cambridge University, Beyond the Cold War, A New Approach to the Arms Race and Nuclear Annihilation. Now, the article is called Anti-Nuclear Fantasies. And the whole thrust of the article is to show that the people in the anti-nuclear movement are really indulging in a great deal of unnecessary melodramatics. And they are being irresponsible in making it appear that the prospect of nuclear war is far more serious than they need to do. Now, he begins by, Mr. Glynn, in reviewing these two books, begins by saying, the anti-nuclear movement has typically expressed itself in broad emotional gestures of public protest, marches and rallies, theatrical demonstrations of the horrible effects of nuclear bombs, popular referenda for some sort of freeze on the arms race. But along with this popular protest, a specialized literature has been forming, a growing corpus of anti-nuclear books that attempt to provide more specific theoretical underpinnings for the movement. The best known of these books is Jonathan Schell's The Fate of the Earth. Two major new additions to the genre are Indefensible Weapons and Beyond the Cold War. In Indefensible Weapons, Robert J. Lifton and Richard Falk direct our attention to a phenomenon called nuclearism, which they define as the psychological, political, and military dependence on nuclear weapons, the embrace of the weapons as a solution to a wide variety of human dilemmas, most ironically that of security. At different points in the text, nuclearism is characterized as a disease, a fundamentalist religion, and an addiction. Now, Mr. Glynn, throughout his article characterizing these two books, is compelled to admit that none of these writers are communists or pro-communists. In fact, he admits in one or two sentences that they also point out the effects in Russia of the nuclear arms race. But he concludes, it would be tempting to dismiss this perspective on politics as transparently Marxist and pro-Soviet, and indeed in no small measure it is both. Neither Falk nor Thompson seems quite capable of passing up an opportunity to disparage the United States or to frame an excuse for the Soviet Union. Now, it happens that I had the opportunity to read a condensation of Thompson's book, Beyond the Cold War, in the Yale Review, the last issue of the Yale Review. And it is very clear from reading that condensation of his book, which he approved, that he is not building a case against the United States. He is building a case against nuclear war per se. There's no question about that. But this writer, Patrick Glynn, is so disturbed about the attack on the Reagan program of the building up for nuclear war that he spends all of his time and all of his space in this article attacking those who criticize Reagan without saying what he thinks should be the proper stance. And he brings in the German Green Movement, which he considers to be anarchist. And in a certain sense, it is anarchist, and I don't think that's a term of opprobrium. Now, there is a shift at a level, he concludes his article. There is a, he quotes Thompson, there is a shift at a level below politics, expressed in style, this is Thompson's view, in sound, in symbol, in dress, which could be more significant than any negotiations now taking place in Geneva. The PA systems of these popular music bands are already capable of making transcontinental sounds. The bands may not be expert arms negotiators, but they might blast the youth of Europe into each other's arms. These are putatively serious men, but they come very close to telling us that the deepest political dilemma of our time will be solved by rock and roll. That's the level of the analysis of the nuclear war approaching. Now, just to go back for a moment to the early writers for commentary, I think is important, because they gave the promise that this would be a serious magazine. And I just want to read a few excerpts from one or two issues to indicate to you how the magazine first started out on a serious level. In the July 1949 issue of Commentary, Irving Kristol, who, as many of us know, became one of the leading spokesmen of the neoconservatives in our time, but he was at that time considered a liberal. He wrote a review of Reinhold Niebuhr's Faith and History. Judaism, I'm quoting him, is tormented by the fact that the Messiah has not come, while the gas chamber has. Christianity is tormented by the fact that the Messiah did come almost 2,000 years ago, and what difference did it make? Hegel spoke of the slaughter bench of history to which mankind was delivered as part of the cunning of reason, that is, as part of the larger scheme of historical providence. Thus did he nobly synthesize, as only an academic sage could, radical suffering with radical optimism. So with the defeat of the original hope that the end of days was at hand, there began the historical adventures of Western eschatology, in which the religious and anti-religious innovations spent themselves through ecclesiastical obscurantism, medieval messianism, French Enlightenment, German idealism, and Marxism and modern nihilism, which brings us to our own day, no longer Christian, not Jewish, not pagan, but whistling in the dark. At least at that point, they were beginning to have curiosity about serious things, and they did have ability as writers. Now, with the open embracing of the Republican Party and these ads which show exactly where they stand, here's this final ad I want to talk about, unemployed thanks to his union. And we have a picture of Mr. Mac McConnell. At age 66, he suffers from high blood pressure. And then they talk, that's only part of his ideal. That has included attacks on his home and car, 8 slashed tires, and fleeing for his life. This is an ad by the National Right to Work Legal Defense Foundation. This is probably the most extreme rightist group in America today. This is the stance of Commentary in 1983. A useful story of development. Thank you.
matter which one, just
you don't mind what I
just
say.
Look like you're reading.
Conrad Lynn's autobiography is called There Is a Fountain and is available from the publisher Lawrence Hill. This show was made by Diana Agosta, Penny Bender, Shilei Chang, Didi Halleck, David Shulman, Mike Penland, Karen Rogoff, and Lisa Miller. Thanks to George Gross, Arnold Schoenberg, Frederick Rzuski. This show costs $150 studio and $40 tape. All labor is donated. Watch this time spot for Joan Braderman reads National Enquirer, Harry Magdoff reads Monthly Review, and Archie Singham reads Foreign Affairs. Write for a complete schedule for future Paper Tiger shows. Paper Tiger welcomes comments and suggestions. Tune in next week.